The place, Lake Mjosa, Norway, a land of sailors, Vikings, and fearless adventurers. But on the evening of April 24, 1945, a Halifax bomber was shot down on a secret operations mission. An emergency ditching attempt was made, but the aircraft sank 750 feet to the bottom of this very dark and mysterious lake. Using the latest in underwater technology, our program explores a daring attempt by a group of adventurers to rescue this 36,000-pound rare treasure, Halifax aircraft, NA337. Our story begins in the small town of Hamar, Norway. In World War II, Norway was overrun by Nazi Germany, and in defense of their nation, the Norwegian Underground was created. As the war was coming to a close, the objective was to provide precious supplies to the Norwegian Underground. From England, a secret nighttime mission using a Halifax bomber was to be carried out. The six-man crew was made up of young British airmen. Young men just looking forward to the end of the war, but totally unaware of the tragedy that lay ahead. On that fateful night, Halifax NA337 departed from Tarrant Rushton Airfield in England. Their mission? Rendezvous at a secret location near Mikkelberget and drop supplies to the Norwegian underground. The six-man aircrew headed northeast, then swung about to reach the drop location. Using parachutes, the supplies were delivered to their target. It was now time to go home. At the old train bridge at Minnesen, a German anti-aircraft battery lay in waiting. The sky burst forth with machine gun and anti-aircraft fire. Shells cut the starboard wing like paper. With one engine on fire, the flames burned in an uncontrollable rage. Tor Marceau remembers the night as if it was yesterday.
I heard the plane in the night, at 2 o'clock in the night.
You heard it?
I heard the plane. I heard it was something wrong with the plane.
Yes?
Yes.
The motors were... not right.
Yes. No, not right.
Yes.
And I was feeling that they were in danger, and that they were looking down on Mother World. Earth.
Mother Earth,
and
yes.
Yes, yes. And I felt I had contact with the crew.
Yeah, so there was something urgent was happening.
Yes. I heard it.
Wow.
I had a nightmare.
Huh.
Quite a nightmare.
The plane continued to carry the six men to their rendezvous with destiny. Making a critical decision, the pilot decided to ditch the plane on the lake. A few seconds later, they hit. The impact tore the tail completely off. Thomas Waitman, the rear gunner, after striking his head and losing consciousness, woke up underwater. Swimming to the surface, he discovered the nightmare had become a reality. Climbing up on the main fuselage, he realized he would have to act quickly. His only hope of survival, the life raft.
Supposed to come out, as you say, yes, when you land in the water, but it didn't. I suppose it all depends what sort of landing you make, you know. And
how did you get it out? How did you get the dinghy released?
How to go back in again. And
back
the fact that
the
I go... half shot of another water again and pulled the manual. So, you know, the aircraft was nose down.
Yeah.
And your dinghy release is on near the roof. And that go down and pull it. The dinghy came out. And I just came out and the aircraft started to go down. I just managed to, but it came out sort of upside down.
The aircraft eventually filled with water and began to slowly slide below the surface. As the plane disappeared, the men began to react to the extremely cold temperatures of the water and the Norwegian night air.
I got onto the dinghy, and it wasn't long before, you know, of course, I'd lost my boots at the time as well. So my feet, you know, were beginning to freeze as well. And I managed to pull, you know, one or two of the lads over to the dinghy, but they were absolutely dead, and I just couldn't do anything. And I couldn't sort of lift them onto the dinghy either. Not the way that I was either.
Thomas Waitman was the only survivor. As Halifax NA337 came to rest on the lake bottom, 240 meters down, it became locked in a frigid time warp. its existence and location a mystery for over 50 years. In Canada, Carl Casgard, a Canadian Airlines pilot, had spent years searching the world in an effort to locate a Halifax bomber. His objective was to honor our veterans and to remind future generations of Canada's fine war effort. Over 70% of Canada's bomber missions were flown on Handley Page Halifax aircraft, but not one was safe for Canada or for our heritage. In Toronto, we visited Jeff Jeffrey, a World War II Halifax bomber pilot. Awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross as a member of RCAF 432 Squadron, Jeff was contacted by Carl. Knowing Jeff's passion for locating a Halifax, they formed a unique team. Was this dream possible? Could they actually find a Halifax bomber? In 1994, Carl read about the legend of the Lake Miosa Halifax. After traveling to Norway several times, he finally met with two Norwegian historians, Tor Marceau and Rolf Lieberg. They talked about the Halifax and of building a Canadian memorial to the bomber crews. Convinced of Carl's sincerity, Marceau and Lieberg produced an electrifying document, an unmistakable sonar image of Halifax NA337.
To about here.
Yes.
And as Dag Amrud has marked the aircraft, she's right in about there.
Tor Marceau decided to show Carl just how much the Norwegian people appreciated the efforts of the Allies. In a wooded area just a few hundred feet from the lake stood a monument erected to honor the airmen who had died in their effort to help the Norwegian people.
All the names of the guys?
Yeah, of course, yes. And the one missing.
Yep.
Flight Lieutenant Turnbull, DFC pilot. Flight Lieutenant Mitchell, navigator. Flight Sergeant Bassett, flight engineer. Flight Sergeant Tuckett, air gunner. Flight Sergeant Naylor, wireless operator. And Flight Sergeant Thomas Waitman, lone survivor. That's a fine memorial.
And you got the Hercules engines on
yes,
it.
Yes, on it, yes.
Yes, yes. Accurate. Yes,
accurate.
Good,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's a wonderful, wonderful memorial.
After seeing the sonar charts and the compassionate dedication of the people of Hamar, Carl was on the phone to Canada.
In the spring of 1994, Carl phoned me one day and said, I found a Halifax. I believe that there's been so many good things happen to bring this all together that the chance opportunity of Carl meeting these gentlemen who knew where the aircraft was, the meeting with the people who are doing the salvaging, the help we've received from the government, the some 2,000 veterans in Canada who have donated money and become members of the Halifax Aircraft Association, and all the dramatic letters that we have received from all these people who have not only talked about how great that wonderful aircraft was, but how important it is that it be restored and maintained in the memory of their comrades who have passed away. And I'm part of this, and I feel, I don't know why I am, but I'm sure glad. It's hard to realize that I was a 20-year-old kid, and here I am, an old man, and I'm playing a part in history, and I think that's probably what it's all about.
The first priority was to find the best possible way of reaching the aircraft. At a depth of 750 feet, it was a factor that needed serious consideration. Using the latest in computer technology, the options were slowly narrowed down. Several expert underwater salvage companies were approached. In the end, Dacon Subsea of Norway was chosen. An underwater remote operated vehicle was to be used for the mission. Equipped with a front-mounted camera and rubber tank treads, It was capable of diving and crawling along the bottom. But how would they lift the plane? In Norway, Dag Amerud, chief diver and team leader, along with Gunnar Gunderson of Dacon Subsea, devise a plan for the rescue. Using a series of precise calculations, the team creates a collection of innovative ideas for the project. Using the underwater ROV camera, this fascinating descent into the depths of Lake Miosa is captured on videotape. Finally, there it was, what they'd been searching for so long. Halifax NA337. With the recovery operations beginning to take shape in Norway, the Canadian crew stops over in England to find out what made this famous aircraft so special. Richard Hawthorne in London remembers the first time he saw Halifax.
When I met the crew, we didn't know what we were flying, what we were going to fly in ops. We were posted down to Yorkshire, a place called Ruffith, just north of York, a place called a conversion unit. And there we learned we were going to fly Halleys, Halifaxes. I didn't know anything about a Halifax. But it didn't take us long to begin to understand that we were very, very lucky. This was 1943. The early Halifaxes, the ones and the twos, there were problems with that aircraft, especially in the tailplane, and there were a lot of very unfortunate accidents. We flew the threes with the square tailplanes and the Bristol Hercules engines. The earlier ones had the Merlins, and it was a beautiful aircraft. It really was. Myself, as a navigator, I was overjoyed. My compartment was down below the pilot. Right below the pilot was the wireless operator. Next to him was the navigator's compartment, then the nose, and the nose was where the bomb member was. In the Lank, the navigator's compartment was upstairs behind. The Halifax was a beautiful aircraft, and myself, I was only young, but I was very interested about the Halley, because the Lank had all the glory, all the honor, and I began to ask questions, and I began to find out things which made me feel great. The structural built of the Halifax was superior to the Lank. You know, the way the aircraft was built. And we heard stories that in ditching in water, the Lank could break up easily, but the Halifax, you had a better chance. They held together.
It was the sort of airplane that the aircrew tell me they'd like to be in if they're going to war. It was good and strong, and you could get out of it. All of those things were not always applicable to some of the other four engine bombers. So the Halifax had this great facility for making its people feel at home in it, and they could depend on it, and particularly with the Hercules engine variety, the piston, the air-cooled engines. They were very good because they gave a lot of power at altitude, which means you could go very high. In fact, they outflew the Lancaster later on in the war.
Victor Bingham, author of Halifax, second to none.
Well, a number of aircraft were fitted with what was called a VG recorder, which was to basically check the G loadings on the airframe. And in one particular instance, on the 6th of December 1944, a particular Halifax called LV917, or serial number 917 of 158 Squadron, returning from operations on Osnabrück, flying in 10th Cloud, went out of control. Possibly the autopilot disengaged, which was a quite frequent thing. It went out of control into a vertical dive, and the VG recorder recorded 4.5G on pullout at 385 miles per hour, but it was actually calculated it achieved over 400 miles per hour in the dive. It returned to base satisfactory with a buckle in the wing. But when it was examined, it was considered satisfactory, no need to do anything. So, and that was the strength of the Halifax.
In wartime, air bases like Talthorpe near York, England, were common sights across the British Isles. Carl invites Tony Little, a tail gunner with RCAF 420 Squadron, to recount his memories of his last bombing mission. His Halifax was shot down over Germany. Five crew members, including Tony, became prisoners of war, while two did not survive.
got about three aircraft at a time.
Yeah.
And that's the most that you got really with power
on. Oh, I see.
You had one guy lifting off the end, one guy in the middle, and then the other fellow just lining up, and he'd just be waiting, and as soon as things seemed to be clear, he would brakes off, well, throttles going on first, brakes off, and as he increased the speed going down the runway, more power, until he got down to about here, and at that time, to full power, they went through the gate and then took off.
Man, I'll tell you, I just wish I could, I wish somebody would have recorded that, because to me, that's the sheer power, you know, just that, like you say, the thunder.
Yes.
And that's Canadian thunder.
That's it, that's it. But you have all these other people idling in the background, and they themselves have got their own orchestration. But each of these aircraft taking off, and it would depend on what the occasion was, what the target. Mm-hmm. These people have 4,000 pounders, 500-pound bombs, they have 250-pound bombs,
and they have
incendiary clusters. And again, that depended on the what the target was.
Yeah.
And where it was depended on how much fuel you carried.
What do you feel like right now? You this is the place of your, this is the high point of your combat years to be at Thalthorpe, and how do you feel about it now? What is it? Do you feel proud? Do you know?
Yes, I do. I feel proud, and I feel that in some ways that I'm here not by myself. I'm here with seven crew members, and I like to think that the two that were killed that night are sort of looking down and approving of what we're doing.
Yeah, I can definitely agree.
You're
with
sort
that.
Of walking on hallowed ground.
Yeah, exactly.
But it certainly is a big change. Very little parts of the runway are still here. The mess halls and living quarters are all gone. And perhaps one of the nice things about it all is, instead of an entry into war, as any airfield was, we have all these peaceful fields.
Yeah. But freedom doesn't come without the sacrifice of some.
Well, I think I'd have to go back and quote the Tunnel King, Wally Floody. And in very few words, he put it all together. He said, if you haven't got freedom, you haven't got anything.
Exactly.
So this is what gave us our freedom.
Yeah.
Many risked their lives fighting for freedom. Thousands lost their lives. They were young men, 19, 20, sometimes 25, and then sometimes only 17. After the war was over, a very strange thing happened. There were so many airplanes lying in fields across Great Britain that a government order was issued to have all non-essential aircraft destroyed. Without any consideration for future generations, all but a few Halifax bombers were scrapped. At the Yorkshire Air Museum in England, volunteers have worked for a number of years rebuilding a Halifax bomber using a collection of parts from a number of other aircraft. This beautiful restoration project is something the British veterans are very proud of. Arriving in Hamar, Norway, the Dacon team is about to lift the first piece of the aircraft, the tail section. Carl meets with Tor Marceau and Lieutenant Doug Rutley of the Canadian Armed Forces. Doug's team of professional engineers will be arriving soon to become part of the recovery team.
Conditions just like now?
Yes.
Well, that's what we need, because as long as the wind doesn't blow, we're going to have it done on schedule. But we'll just have to hope for the best and make sure that if we have to, we'll work at night, huh? Because yes. Obviously the wind is going to be a little bit less at night.
Yes.
When the plane sank, the tail section broke off from the main body. Dacon believed lifting this piece was the first logical step in the project's schedule. Using the ROV, Dog attaches cables to the rear bulkheads, and slowly but surely the tail section is lifted from the water.
It's just marvelous, seeing the Halifax out of the water like that, the tail. It's in remarkably good condition, considering all it's been through. I'm really looking forward to bringing it back home and putting it back together, putting it on display. That would be just super.
The next morning, Carl and his son Jonathan meet with Otgarda to inspect the tail's condition as it lay at the Hias water plant. Otgarda was more than eager to supply a landing area at the beach and a storage facility for the project.
Four machine guns.
Elimination.
Oh, the bullets.
Yeah, 303s. You can see the belts of machine gun bullets in there. And I wonder how far back the bullets go. So this is Thomas Waitman's office. You know Thomas Waitman, Newcastle?
When we asked why he was providing his storage facility for free, Otgarda told us that in World War II, his uncle had been trained as a navigator for the RAF at a place called Little Norway, or as we know it today, Toronto Island Airport. Damage from the crash is evident as Carl inspects the tail's condition, noting its remarkable ability to survive the elements.
Look at this. Look down here. Hardly any corrosion at all. So you can see where it's been in the mud? See, it's down in the mud? That's good. Good preservation down there. See, look at this. Look at this fitting.
Whoa. There's no corrosion at all.
There's no corrosion on that. Those screws are like brand new.
So oxygen available.
Yeah, see the mud where there's no oxygen? The mud has preserved it.
Down by the lake, the lifting device named Moby Grip has arrived at dockside.
These are custom fit to the inside, the curvature underneath the wing of the Halifax profile of the wing. And so it's gonna be slid under the wing. The main spar, front main spar, will be here, and the rear main spar will be here, and that will support the spars will take the force of the lift.
The plane is not laying horizontally. It's not possible to start to lift in a wire with an ordinary lifting wire, because all the weight will be on that special wire, and the other one will pick up later, and that's too late because the wire will break.
Yes.
You are not able to get an equal lift on every wires.
Mm.
Therefore, we had to look into to a system that would take care of the forces at the same time.
This animated view created by Scott Knox shows the lifting device in precise detail. Its design is critical to the recovery operation.
And our lifting device is gripping this through in between these two engines.
Yes, the two inner engines, right?
Inner engines, and is lifting, and the lifting, the point of lifting will be in the main spar.
Mm.
And you have a secondary lifting point in the aft spar. And that is the way that we will try to lift it.
The plan now calls for a heavy barge to be included in the scenario. Welders work at one end, strengthening the holding rack that will lower Moby Grip to the bottom. For the first time, Jeff sees the aircraft's tail section, and emotions and memories of the war begin to return. Jeff and Tony were men who had flown in Halifaxes during the war. Jeff is a pilot, and Tony a tail gunner. They were both well aware of the dangers of flying in battle. Seeing a section of the Halifax bomber was a moment they had been waiting for a long, long time. Finally, the crew was ready. It's time to raise the Halifax. The aircraft is located in the middle of a lake, nearly 1,000 yards from shore. The control room, housed in a structure sitting on top of a floating barge, is equipped with diving gear, the ROV's control panel, and a series of video monitors. With these, Dag, Gunner, and the crew can see the plane night or day. The optimism is still there, and they had the tail. It couldn't be too much more work to lift 36,000 pounds of airplane, 750 feet straight up, but then one must always expect the unexpected. With a storm front rising over the top of the Norwegian hills, the rain had quietly begun to fall. Gunner, Dag, and the crew worked throughout the night with the weather conditions changing by the minute. Suddenly, with the ROV in the water, the unexpected happened. The ROV had been hit. Lightning had struck the water nearby, causing the power transformer to blow. Now it would take Thor and Martin 36 hours to repair the damage. On board the barge, preparations are made to lower the lifting device into the water. It is an intriguing sight to see this strange-looking barge out in the middle of a Norwegian lake, but everyone living there knew what was happening. The word was out and people were beginning to take notice of this important historical event. But to the crew, it becomes more apparent that this was more than a recovery project. It had become a special event in their lives. A monumental task that, if successful, would not only be a world's record lift, but also a magnificent contribution to aviation heritage. Finally, Dog is ready to deploy the ROV and set up a communications link between the control room and the aircraft. The DACON crew unload the robot and let it slip gently into the water. It will dive 237 meters to the plane's location and relay television pictures back to the control room. As the ROV waits for the lifting device to make its descent, paint is applied to the cable. These marks will act as reference points as Moby Grip slowly descends into the darkest depths of Lake Mjøsa. Once again, trouble.
The main ROV is stuck, and we don't like to go further on with the lifting device before we know exactly what position it is, and eventually try to pick it up before we're lifting the plane, so we don't destroy anything.
A second ROV is brought in by truck. Similar to the DACON remote-operated vehicle, this underwater mini-sub was on a mission to search, locate, and untangle the DACON probe. At first sight, it's serious. The ROV has become entangled around the lifting device. This was the kind of setback that could cause more delays. One of the cables had made a real mess of the situation. They had lost the sub once before, when they were bringing up the tail. The ballast tanks on the side of the unit are designed to raise the ROV automatically to the surface, if the main cables are ever disconnected. In that incident, after a few hours, the system had worked. This time it was different, and much more serious. The ROV was caught, and these cables were much too deep for a diver to reach. Now the entire mission was in jeopardy. With their remote control devices, the two men untangled the robotic web as the ROVs danced underwater. With each attempt, the web slowly unraveled. Suddenly, with the crew gently tugging on the cable, the ROV was free. Dag and Gunner were relieved. As the two ROVs made their way to the surface, You couldn't help but think these machines were an intricate part of the crew. You could see the relief on Dog's face as the Dacon ROV reached the surface. Like a long-lost pet, the ROV was back, and the crew was ready to start again. Sunday morning, and while we're waiting for the rough weather to clear, we decided to let Thomas Waitman tell us about how he survived the night of April 24, 1945. Carl takes Thomas out to the lake and retraces his path. Throughout the night, the other five crew members had perished from hypothermia. Coming to the realization that he was the only survivor, he watched as the sun slowly rose above the hills. Fortunately for Thomas, his cries were heard by a young Norwegian. Thomas Waitman was picked up in a small rowboat and carried to shore.
But that day in 45, April 24, how long had you been out there? I mean, from till the time you were rescued?
Since about 1 o'clock, since about half past 1 or 1 o'clock.
Yeah. So six hours?
Yes. It was still, yes.
Okay, now I know the temperature was around zero.
Yeah.
And there was a bit of a wind blowing.
Yeah.
And you had some of your clothes on, but your boots were missing.
My boots were missing and my socks as well. I took my socks off. Save my feet, at least I thought it was better.
Well, it's hard to say, but they're still here, so.
Yeah, that's right.
But, you must have been really feeling the cold.
Oh, I was, absolutely. Yes.
So you wouldn't have lasted much longer then?
I don't think so.
Wow. You went in the old farmhouse where you got back your body heat.
Yeah.
After 50 years, Thomas Waitman returns to thank the ones who saved his life in 1945. At a small farmhouse on the hill, Thomas is greeted by one of his rescuers, Mrs. Vethammer.
Halifax bomber?
Yeah. They're gonna lift it up.
Inside, the greeting is the same as it had been 50 years earlier. Warmth and human kindness.
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
Later that evening, Jeff Jeffrey had a very special surprise for Thomas Waitman.
When you took off, what did you take with you?
Just a cup of a flask of coffee. That was all, maybe.
That was all. You don't have any coffee tonight.
I'll get some later.
I think we got some here. Coffee. I think we got some here for you.
Oh. You found it.
What does it say on there? You can't read your name?
I can't. Oh, yeah. I thought it had been rusted away by now. In fact, you know.
With that bloody coffee you guys made?
Have you tried it? Have you tried the coffee?
I wouldn't dare. I wouldn't dare.
That might be still hot.
As the weather clears, Moby Grip is once again positioned in front of the plane. It is important to note that the aircraft is leaning to one side, thus the device must be inserted on an angle. The lifting device alone weighs over 2,500 pounds, and the cable attached to the barge must be strong enough to lift the entire aircraft from the bottom. Inside the control room, final calculations are made. Dag uses the ROV monitors to watch each and every move of the operation. At times, he wonders if the plane will ever give way to his recovery attempts. He knows that once the aircraft is on the lift, there's no turning back. One mistake here, and the plane could go crashing down to the bottom. A final attempt is made to ease the lifting device into place. Steadied by the ROV and the extra guidelines attached to the tugboat on the surface, Moby Grip slides into position. The first operation is to free the plane from the mud. Surprisingly, after a few moments, the gauges on the barge register to Dag and the crew that the plane has freed itself. The time has come to lift the plane. As the Halifax reaches the surface, Jeff and Dag are elated to see the main body of the aircraft. Overnight, the plane is slowly lowered onto a special towing sled as preparations are made at the beaching area. But time is running out. Within 12 hours, Jeff will have to return to Canada.
So, Doug, I guess you're taking Jeff off to the airport. Is that the plan?
No, actually, I think Jeff's finally made a decision on this. He's going to stick it out and actually see the airplane come up. We're not that far away, but if he's to make his airplane, he's got to leave almost immediately. So he's going to tough it out and stay here for until the airplane is done.
What made your decision there, Jeff?
I just couldn't leave. It's too damn important. I got to be here. It's almost there, and I can't walk away with it almost being there. I want to see it. So to hell with everything else. The world stops right now, and I'm going to stay here until it's up.
After 4 weeks of attempting to raise the Halifax, it is now time to see it break the surface of the water. With the cable wheel rolling, the magnificent Halifax is about to make its return. What an incredible story. The lives of so many people are caught up in the excitement, anticipating the plane's arrival. With powerful emotions changing by the minute, the Canadians, the British, and the Norwegians are about to see a dream come true. What many had said was an impossible mission is now becoming a reality. As the heavy cable continues to pull the Halifax towards the beach, we learn that this was not the first time Thomas Waitman had endured such a terrifying experience. Sometime before the mission over Norway with Halifax NA337, Thomas had been on a training flight in another aircraft. The plane had gone down with a full crew on board, and incredibly, once again, Thomas had been the only survivor. In his quiet manner, Thomas Waitman admitted to having a series of dreadful nightmares since that tragic night in 1945. But now, as the aircraft is beginning to break the surface, there is something different in the air. This time it is a sign of hope, a sign of triumph. The DECON crew temporarily stops the cable device to make a quick inspection of the plane. We find the aircraft is still in excellent condition, considering it had to withstand the underwater elements for over 50 years. Just inches below the surface, you can just barely make out the nose section, which has been partially crushed, probably from the impact of the crash. As Jeff studies the starboard wing, the engines, and the air intakes, he is confident that the plane can be restored to its original state. Now it's just a matter of pulling the plane about 200 feet to the shore. Even the cockpit appears to be intact. Some of the windows are gone, but you can see the incredible strength of the Halifax by the fact that the main spar and much of the fuselage have withstood this extraordinary lift from 750 feet down.
What time is it, Jeff?
I missed my airplane. It's 10, 15 minutes to take off. But we're taking off here, and this is the better takeoff for me.
Another stunning setback. The special towing sled had been smashed, and now someone had to figure out how to lift the plane off the rocks. The next morning, Carl returns from Canada to see the Halifax for the first time.
So what's your feelings right now, Carl?
Oh, I don't know. It's pretty heavy duty, you know. You bust your buns for 2 years, and sometimes when you spend, you know, late nights doing all kinds of things, just pushing and pushing and pushing, and you sacrifice, and then you hope that your dream comes true. And now, you know, it's pretty heavy duty.
What do you think now that you see it?
Well, she's kind of beat up, but I'll take it. Rusty, looks a little dirty, but I think it's the best treasure Canada will ever have. Can't believe it.
In his hand, Carl carries the hat of Len Hosey, a Canadian Halifax bombing. Len had died recently, and Carl was eager to keep a promise he had made to his friend, a promise to let Len be close to a Halifax. Finally, Carl had kept his promise. It was now or never. Night had fallen, and the team decides to lift the plane by building a road out to the Halifax. Truckloads of stone and gravel are brought in. The first attempt is a failure. The front end loaders are not capable of lifting the aircraft. The next day, more rock is added to the roadway. This time, a 50-ton crane is rolled out to the plane. Within an hour, it becomes apparent it's not going to budge. The plane is not moving. It's day three, and we're watching as heavier equipment is brought in for the job. The sight is incredible. Massive Caterpillar tractors are rolled out to the edge of the Halifax on a roadway many are saying looks like a major highway. Hundreds of gallons of fuel and water are pumped from the wings to lighten the plane. As one of the big cats makes its way out to the aircraft, Dag and the crew stand on the wings, looking for any points of weakness. A mistake here could tear the plane completely apart. Finally, this is it. The moment had come. Halifax NA337 is about to perform its most important assignment since that night in 1945. And from depths unknown, the men would cry, "Raise high the glass of victory, for there are those who seldom speak, though honor is their destiny. I watched in silence as the great ship rose, its power and magnificence. We all were humbled at the sight, this great moment, time significant. For the magic spell had broken down, the Halifax was free, as it rose upon the distant shore, in awe for all to see. And great men died and great men lived, for freedom was the dream. And nevermore for all of time will this legend lie unseen. Today, the journey of Halifax NA337 has come full circle. At the RCAF Memorial Museum in Trenton, Ontario, Canada, the Halifax is being restored to its original state. With hard work and with enough money through financial contributions and sponsorships, this fine aircraft will be on display for future generations to see a part of history that must never be forgotten. And by the way, those nightmares that Thomas Waitman had experienced on so many nights since 1945, the day Halifax NA337 reached the shore of Lake Mimosa, Thomas Waitman's nightmares ended. Perhaps the closing of a tragic event? Who knows? But what lies here today is a result of mankind's ability to span the bridges of invention and creativity. A result of human resourcefulness, determination, and something we all cherish in our lives, called freedom.
Yes, but it's for our history, our past, the people that fought in that war, and I don't think we could ever do enough to show what they did and to keep that heritage, to keep that alive so that the future generations can see this. It should be here forever. Once it's finished, it'll be inside, and it should be there forever.
It was the beginning. The aircraft had arrived in Trenton thanks to the recovery team and those dedicated men and women from the Canadian Armed Forces who had disassembled the plane in Norway and transported it back to Canada. It would be a monumental task to rebuild one of the most important aircraft from World War II. The process began in 1995 that would take 10 years to complete, an ambitious dream that could not be discouraged in any way, shape, or form.
Front is going to be our biggest challenge, Jim. It's missing, most of it is missing, right from the wireless operators and navigators, bomb aimers, gunners, forward gunners position, nose glass, it's all gone. Included in that missing stuff is all of the pilot's instrumentation, the panels, the equipment. What we're going to have to do is we're going to have to start over. We start with a single Longeron that'll come out and go out about another 12 feet, and we'll build up frames, we'll build up the cockpit, we'll build up the crew stations, put the seating in. And I would imagine that is going to take us a year to a year and a half, and it'll be the most interesting, but it'll also be the most challenging part of the aircraft. Jim, this is our best. This is our best work. This aircraft, being a special operations executive aircraft, only had one turret, the tail turret with four guns. The mid-upper turret was removed. The space was covered with plywood to get the extra 5 knots. When we looked at them, as you can see, the old guns, they're badly corroded, they're badly damaged, they're badly rotted. We've taken each of the guns, and we've stripped them. We've measured the components that were measurable. Those that weren't measurable, we went to Hamilton, borrowed another gun, copied them, converted them to computer code, and as the machines across the road here in the AMDU machine shop became available, very simply plugged in the code, plugged in a block of aluminium or iron, as it turns out, for the barrel, and would you believe that each of 63 components is complete?
You'll probably remember, Jim, this wasn't here. None of it was here. This was badly damaged in the crash, and this is what our technicians have done to replace it. Some of this such as here, is original. Some of it is new. But this part was badly damaged, and as you see now, it's almost complete. All they have to do is put the skin back on it, and we have a complete tail section.
I think it's a wonderful achievement, and it's the only real, almost living reminder that so many of our boys served in that particular type of aircraft, which has so often been ignored by history.
I think it's wonderful just to have the opportunity to see this, all these people here today on a single cross. I think it's fantastic.
Gentlemen, I would like you to meet those who are the heart and soul of this restoration project. They are Paul Boffin, Project Supervisor, Dave Ablett, John Ashby, Guy Barcy, Jim Benham, Wally Bentley, Duncan Bank, Derek Brown, Glenn Brunton, Rod Clark, Wayne Cowan, John Dawson.
This was a wonderful experience. It was nostalgic in the sense that I was here at Trenton in 1945 to 1949, because I stayed in the Air Force after the war. But to see that aircraft, and I had so many friends who flew Halifaxes, was a wonderful ceremony. It was touching because it brought back memories of Bomber Command. Even though I flew in Wellingtons, the old Wimpy, instead of the Halifax, it brought back a lot of memories from 1941 to 1944.
I was just saying to my friends over there that you really don't get what this represents unless you've watched the construction over the years. But to see this thing standing here, and it's hard to believe we used to fly in it. It's huge, and it was a great, well, it still is a great aircraft, probably one of the better bombers of the Second World War. She was really well built. You felt safe in it, and as the pilots used to say, it climbed like a homesick angel, but it had the glide angle of a brick.
I thought that was extremely well done, well planned, well executed. I'm glad I came. It may be the last time I'll have the opportunity, but this has been wonderful, really.
I was with the crew in Norway in 1995, Jeff and Carl asked me to come over and film the project. They said, come over for a week and we'll get this thing out. About 5 weeks later, I was still sitting on the beach. But the plane came out, and you're about to see it in a few minutes here. It's quite important what this is about to be, because a lot of young people don't know about what these men did, men and women. So there was one night there in 1995, we were sitting around the cabin, and I pulled out the guitar, and Carl was there, and Dag Armour came in the room with the crew, and they started talking, so I listened very carefully to their words and the stories they were telling me about how important this was. And I jumbled the words together, and I came up with this song that you see in the video, if anybody got one of those videos at the
we meet.
Knights of fire from the bridge top. There's a plane that's going down. Watch sky and hear the engines. Lake Miosa coming round. Raise a tail and raise a body. Lift it from the depths of fate. For the men who died believing what they did was worth the wait. And they flew Halifaxes to the sky under the stars. Second to none, the time is coming, rolling thunder from afar. Strength and courage at the touchdown. Told me some men died that night. Only one to tell the story, how the people saved his life. Now the people rise in Norway, come together with the tide. From Canada they join the battle, save the Halifax tonight. Raise a tail and raise a body, lift it from the depths of fate. For the men who died believing what they did was worth the wait. And they flew Halifaxes to the sky under the stars. Second to none, the time is coming, rolling thunder from afar. Raise a tail and raise a body, lift it from the depths of fate. For the men who died believing what they did was worth the wait. And they flew Halifaxes to the sky under the stars. Second to none, the time is coming. Second to none, the time is coming. Second to none, the time is coming. Rolling thunder from afar.